Katie Kempner, and welcome to Perspectives here at the Ipsos Girls Lounge at the Cannes Lion Festival. This is going to be a great week talking to a lot of amazing women, and I'm very excited to start with the first interview of Cannes, talking to Amy Palmer, who's the CEO and founder of Power Women TV. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
It's not too shabby of a place, huh?
I mean, really, when you look back, this is our backdrop, we really couldn't be luckier. So everybody out there, yes, this is as beautiful as it looks on camera.
Yes, it really is. So let's just jump right in a little bit for people that may not know, although I know a lot of people do. Tell me a little bit about Power Women TV.
Power Women TV is the next women's digital network. And when I say next women, I mean, you know, we have our Oprahs, and we have Oxygen, and we have Bravo, and we have all these networks. But what network is really catering to women who want to have it all, want to find out about balance, care about fashion, care about balancing their family's checkbook? So I wanted to create a platform for that woman. And I self-funded it until 2012 when I got an investor. We put it in New York City taxi cabs, which was the greatest marketing move ever for those advertising people out there. I can't even tell you the return on our investment on that one. And you know, we've been launching it ever since. We have original programming, and we just signed a deal with Time Inc. to do more programming for them.
That's phenomenal.
Very exciting.
So what are some of the programs? Because I saw there's a bunch of different great categories.
Yeah. So we have a show called The Interview, which is very much like this, where I sit down with fascinating women and I talk to them about their journeys to success. And I'm really interested in talking to them about things that the general media doesn't really talk about. I'm not looking for that soundbite that's salacious. I don't really want to talk about tabloid. You know, that we have enough of that. So I do that. We have a roundtable discussion show where we talk about things like fertility, family, marriage, relationships, anything that has to do with today's modern woman. We have a health show, we have a fitness show, we have a parenting show. I mean, it really just, fashion, it really just runs the gamut.
So you said something very quickly about having it all. Mm. And we both talked about Arianna Huffington. I recently interviewed her, and I know she is a mentor of yours. And when I interviewed her, she said she hated, and she wrote about this in her new book, Thrive, she hated that phrase, having it all, because already that was pressure. You talk to all these women. What do you feel about that phrase, having it all?
It doesn't exist. And you know, anytime a young woman emails me and says, you know, I really want to do what you're doing, I always say to them, there's always something you will sacrifice for going for something so hard.
Yeah.
So that's really my message to women, is decide what you really want, but know that other things in your life will fall by the wayside. It is impossible to have it all, and I think that it's actually a disservice to women everywhere to try to have it all, and for us to keep talking about it that way.
And I always think, first of all, you have to decide what having it all means to you, because it might not mean the same thing to somebody
Correct.
Else. And then probably having it, whatever you've decided having it all is, you probably can't do it at the same time. You know, you can have it throughout your life, but probably not all at the same
time.
Right,
you definitely can. I think that there are ebbs and flows in life, and you have to decide when you're going to fall back in your career a little bit, when you're going to focus on family, if that's something that you want. But you have to be really clear about what your intentions are and make the best decisions for yourself. And also, a lot of women who've made decisions, if they look and they say the grass is always greener,
yeah.
They want what they don't have. So I also get a lot of that too.
I've asked a lot of guests this over time. Do you think people should sort of have a life plan? And if so, how long? Or do you sort of just wing it?
Yeah, okay, so winging it is not a good idea. I think women who just assume everything's going to work out,
mm-hmm.
That's not a life plan. I do think that you have to be strategic in how you think about your life. If, you know, and I talk to a lot of young women about this, because my generation, we were told we could have it all, but no one told us how to do it.
Right.
So if you have a really successful career, but you don't have children, I educate the younger generation, listen, freeze your eggs by the time you're 30. Really look for a life partner in your 20s or early 30s, and someone who's serious, and don't prolong your adolescence that long, even though our society allows it. I mean, even here in Cannes, like, everybody's partying like they're in college, and that's fine, but understand as a woman, you have to make the right choices for yourself if that's something that you want.
Yeah. People never understand in Cannes. Like, what happens in Cannes does not stay in Cannes.
It is not like Vegas, no.
It is not like Vegas. I don't think it really often stays in Vegas anyway. So there's so much conversation now about women in the workplace, which is really what I'm very focused on, balance. But, and, you know, we have that thanks to Sheryl Sandberg, Arianna Huffington. It's definitely, the conversation has been extraordinarily elevated. But do you think it's the right conversations?
The conversations are great because it started a dialogue. Mm-hmm. But what I really hope is that the everyday woman is able to relate to or have a role model that they feel like they can be on par with. I think right. It's hard to look at someone like Sheryl Sandberg or Arianna Huffington and say, well, you know, Sheryl, you went to Harvard and you have staff around you to help you and you're making X amount of millions a year. That's not relatable to the average woman. And I think that, and Arianna as well, even though I greatly respect her path, I just think that women need to look at someone who's relatable to them, who's not a multimillionaire, who is trying to do it all. And that's really what Power Women TV tries to do, is give them role models that they can say, I want to be friends with her.
Let's talk a little bit about your life and
Sure. How
you know, your career path and how you came to where you are today.
Sure. I got my first job at MTV, and I worked on a show called Daria, which was an animated show, which, by the way, today is still like the coolest thing I've done. Everybody is like Daria, and I'm thinking, no, Power Women, but everyone just wants to talk about Daria. From there, I went to VH1, MTV, and then I took a 90% pay cut at the age of 29 and decided I wanted to really pursue the on-air thing. Mm-hmm. So I went out to a startup network in the Hamptons called Plum TV.
Oh, right.
And I basically made $500 for the whole summer, got some tape, came back to New York, and I had two job offers. One was from CNN. At the time, they had just moved into the Time Warner Center. It was this beautiful steel building and just couldn't be more glamorous. And it was as a booker, so I'd be booking guests on a show. And the other one was working for NYC TV, which was run by the city of New York in the municipal building downtown, taking three subways from where I lived, same salary, but I could be on air. And I chose that one. That was the harder choice. But I'm glad I did, because I became an entrepreneur. I created my show, I booked it, I did all the branded segments, I put people on television who had never been on TV before, and now they're co-hosting The View. So it really showed me what I was supposed to be doing, which wasn't just on air, it was also behind the scenes. And then that was how Power Women TV started, because I was going around New York doing these entertainment segments, and then all of a sudden my show became more business oriented. Mm-hmm. And I thought, why is there not a show about women in business? And I wanted to create that. And that's when YouTube showed up, and someone said, why don't you just start to put it on YouTube? So I put it on YouTube, and then the response was overwhelming. And wrote a business plan, got an investor, and by the way, this all sounds really easy, but it has been a really crazy journey. And, you know, he believed in me, and we built out what is now, and it's still growing. And, you know, sometimes you think to yourself, how much longer is this going to take? And I just want to say, you know, I had the idea in 2007, and we're in 2014. So if you're really committed to something, you have to be strategic in your commitment and really understand that it takes a long time to be successful. It's not quick.
Right. So actually, there was a lot of great advice woven into that answer about, you know, necessarily going for the harder choices and being patient and striving. But I'd just like to sort of close and ask, if there's one piece of advice that you could share with the people here walking around Cannes and everybody who's listening that has guided you through your life, what would it be?
Listen to your gut. It's totally cliche, but I've heard so many powerful women, performers behind the scenes say, anytime I didn't listen to my gut, it always ended up being a disaster. So I would say, listen to your gut, know what's right. If you're really talented, it'll always rise. I have a phrase that I always say that says, talent always rises. So whenever you have a setback in your life, if you're talented, you're gonna be fine. So that's my advice.
That's great advice. It was a pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.